God is good all the time. He is very good. Amen. How many of y'all know we're in the last days? We're in the last minutes. You know, there's so much confusion and stuff over the area of government and so forth. You know, people, they try to separate government from church, which is against God's word. In fact, you know who started government? God. In fact, didn't he place his kings in government? Amen? It's incredible what's going on, isn't it? So they're trying to keep the church out of the government. Let me tell you, the church runs the government. In fact, they should be running the government. But right now we know the devil's running the government. Amen? So we got to make a change. And there's a change coming, isn't there? There's a move of God coming. We're in it right now. Revival has been happening. It's overflowing. But if you're not in position, you miss it. Everything revolves around position. We stay in position. You get it. You get moved out of position. You miss it. Amen? And that's what the enemy does. He tries to keep us out of position so we miss it. And one thing we don't want to do is miss God. We don't want to miss him. There's a tremendous impression. The atmosphere is changing. So that means you and I got a battle to keep the atmosphere changed according to God's will. See, we change the atmosphere to bring God's presence. That's why we worship. Amen? So as we change the atmosphere to bring God's presence, we can receive what he's saying. But one of the things the enemy is doing is trying to influence and exchange God's presence for the things of the world, which is false. It's a false presence of God. It's called religious. People get religious instead of relationship. What the enemy loves to do is disconnect. If he can disconnect you, you miss God. He disconnects in so many, of course, the first thing is sin disconnects. Amen? How about discouragement? Things that add oppression disconnect. Spirits disconnect us. Medication will disconnect you. Mental medication disconnects you. Is everybody with me? All of these things, God is trying to bring a reconnection to his body so we can be one accord, one mind in the flow of his spirit. His purpose is to set the people free, not to bring us in bondage. He says something very powerful. I come to give you life and life abundantly, but the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And that wasn't just because it was written on that day. It's still going on every day. Amen? Our fight is not flesh and blood. It's powers of darkness and wickedness in heavenly places. But there's something that you and I must do to not only stay in position, and not only to battle to stay in position, but there's an area where we want to get to where God requires a qualified release. In other words, there's something you must do to release something from God. Does everybody understand that? Is everybody with me? It's called qualified release. Everyone say, I want to get qualified to release the promise of God. See, people are waiting on God to do something. God is saying, get in position, and when you do what I ask you to do, then I'll release it. And then people get angry with God. Why didn't you answer my prayer? Because you didn't do what he asked you to do first. In Romans chapter 8, would you go there with me for a moment? Qualified releases. You know, God's got a storehouse of things for me and you. He's not trying to hold anything back from us, but he's trying to get it released to us. Release means that you must qualify to do something to get it released. There's a requirement. And in that requirement means that we must meet his criteria, not ours. Is everybody with me? We must meet whose criteria? His, not ours. And when we meet that criteria, it actually gets us in position to receive something. Romans 8, verse 1. Is everybody there? Everybody okay? Are you ready? Would you read it with me? Verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Well, that's beautiful. That's wonderful. But now there's a requirement. For no condemnation to those who accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. There is a requirement. What is it? who do not walk according to the what? The flesh, but according to the Spirit. Oh, that's pretty simple. Because if you're walking according to the flesh, you are disqualified. Is everybody with me? If you're walking according to the Spirit, you are qualified. Why? Because those who are led by the Son, by the Spirit of God are sons of God. It keeps us in position. It's a righteous requirement. It's a qualified release of His promise. It's a meeting of His criteria. It's a place of position to receive. He says this, he said, verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, He condemned sin in the flesh, that the what? Righteous requirement, everyone say righteous requirement, is a qualified release of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk what? According to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Everybody wants something from God. Everybody. There isn't a person I don't know that doesn't want something from God. Even an unbeliever. Even atheists want something from God. Believe me, when they get in trouble, they go, oh God. They want something. Everybody wants something from God. And God wants to give everyone something. Of course, the first thing He wants to get everyone is salvation. So there's a requirement, a qualified arena for salvation. What is it? Repent of your sins and believe in Jesus Christ, that He paid the price for you, died for you, that you're washed by His blood, and you've given your life to Him. That is a requirement. Without that requirement, there is no salvation. So everything has a requirement. Everything. You want something from God? He says, do this, and then I'll do that. But too many times, there's that false belief system, that mentality that says, I want without doing anything. I want without doing, I call it a welfare mentality. I'm just going to go get without any, don't have to qualify for it. Of course, people got to qualify for all those things there. You know what the qualification is? They got to meet every criteria of nothing. I mean, you know, hello. Hallelujah. Now, being a person on disability has got to qualify it. Amen? There's got to be a problem. The problem is they're giving too many people disability that have demons. And they call them nuts. Bipolar. They think up anything because they don't know how to deal with it. The secular world does not know how to deal with a demon. They know how to give a person medication to try and control the flesh. That's it. Oh, I'm a manic depressant. Well, you're, because you got a demon of oppression. You get rid of the spirit, you're free. I was an addict for 20 years. They always told me I would always be an addict. What the heck would I live for then? So I tried to kill myself. That didn't work. Thank God I didn't qualify for that one. Somebody was praying for me. That's why. God rescued me from hell. Because if I had died in that condition, that's where I would have been. Because I disqualified salvation in my life. But I was always told I was going to be an addict and always an addict. Oh, man, what am I going to do then? What's the heck? Until Jesus came. You know what happened? That spirit left me, and I know I haven't had a desire to use drugs for over 23 years. Because it's a spirit. I don't need any medication. I get medicated by the presence of God. And the fruit of it is peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. I am drunk in the Spirit. That's what I love. I love to get high. But I'm going to get high in his presence, not a counterfeit high that makes me disconnected and stupid. Hello? Okay. Should we go a little further? Did it get hot in here? Snap. In verse 5, are you ready? Let's speak it. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Now, the things of the flesh are not only lust and things, but it's according to the ways of the world. We don't live according to the requirements and the ways of the world anymore. We are of another kingdom. I'm a citizenship of an eternal place, not of a temporary place. Does everybody get it? You want to stay temporary, then do the things that are temporary, and you become temporary. Hallelujah. It says this. Are you ready? For the to be what? Carnally minded is death. So to be fleshly minded, to put your mind on the things, to put your dependence on the things of the world is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So your dependency is on the one who is the true source of all things. Then I'm going to receive life and peace. But if I'm dependent on the world, then I'm going to end up dead. Because he's my source and everything else is a resource. Amen? It says this in verse 7. Are you ready? Because to be what? Carnally minded is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor can it be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Can't please God. They can't please God. So if you can't please God, can you go home? Heck no. That's a requirement. What? To please God. A requirement is to do his will. That's a requirement. What that releases qualified release of, well, what's the release? Salvation. We all want to be saved. We all want something from God. But are we willing to pay the price? And the paying the price, what is the price? Cooperation. That's the price. That's the price of freedom. We sow our way to freedom. Is everybody okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 6. You know, one of the things that the Lord sets is boundaries for our protection in our life. Is everybody all right? He sets boundaries for protection. God is not looking at us to punish us. Amen? He's looking at us to rescue us. When we blow it, he doesn't look at us and go, I'm going to kill you. He may look at us, you bonehead. Says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. In other words, people are easily deceived. Doesn't mean people are bad. It means they're just deceived. So when a person does something displeasing to God because their influence is influenced from demonic forces and they're displeasing to God because of choices being made. We cannot make our choices by how we feel. You make your choice by how you feel, you always be misled. Well, this is just how I feel. Oh, how about what the truth is? Well, I don't know what the truth is. Well, then you're going to be led by how you feel. So, you know what a requirement is? We are to seek out what truth is of God. You know how many believers don't even read the Bible? They read the newspaper more. They read their horoscopes. And they bring curses on their life and wonder why things are happening. Why the devil comes and steals and kills. They read other things more than they do the Bible. The Bible is a manual, an instruction manual for freedom. It's a training manual. You know, when you need to fix something, you go to Google and you look up a manual, right? Okay, how to fix this? And it tells you this. Well, you want to fix something, you go to this in your life. This is life fixing. Life fixing. And when you cooperate with this, God fixes us because we can't. We tried and failed. So when we get into a place of survival mode, that means we're trying to fix us. Survival mode. But when you get a place of surrender mode, you're letting God fix you. Now you're saying, okay, Lord, you build the house, not me, because every time I build it, it falls. Every time I try to fix it, I mess it up. And you know what? You usually have parts left over when you try and fix it. Did you ever get something? You know, my wife, you know, she'd get something. She goes, will you put this together? Oh, snap. Sure, where's the directions? Ain't enough pictures on this one. And I always have parts left over. Hey, you know, but that's okay. I use it for something else then, you know, down the road. I got to a point where I just gather it up, put it away, and don't even tell her I got parts left over. Yeah, does it work? Good. It's solid and sturdy, no problem. In fact, I usually have to add some of my own parts from the ones that I left over from before. But it gets solid. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. God always makes a way of escape. Let's continue on this training. In verse 11, would you read it with me? 2 Corinthians 6, 11. All Corinthians, we have spoken openly to you. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your affections, your emotions, your feelings, your desires. It says you're restricted. Why? They're being disqualified then of a release from God. And then he shares with, he says, okay, here it is. Are you ready? Now, in return for the same, I speak to you as children. You also be open. Here it is. Here's the requirements. Are you ready? What God's saying, look at me, you're disqualified. Let's get qualified and get you something. Do not be unequal in the yoke with unbelievers. Hello. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? I'm going to share something with you, very important. You want to disqualify yourself? Vote for someone that promotes abortion and same-sex marriage. You get disqualified. And blood is on your hands. You put a person in office that promotes abortion and same-sex marriage, there's blood on your hands. And people wonder why things are happening. Okay, let's go a little further. For what communion has light with righteousness? Right? Verse 15. And what accord has Christ with Belial? And what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with what? Idols. Idols. For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them, I'll walk among them, I'll be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore what? Come out from among them. If you come out from among them, that's a requirement. Be separate, says the Lord, and don't touch what is what? Unclean. Unclean. What's unclean? Things that are of the world are unclean. Booze is unclean. Hello. Drugs is unclean. Sexual perversion is unclean. Pornography is unclean. All these things that are unclean. See, we already know what's unclean. We were born with knowing what's unclean and clean. We know it, but we justify it. How many of y'all know disobedience is unclean? How many of y'all know rebellion is unclean? So not only are you not supposed to touch it, you're not supposed to agree with it. Because it says anyone who agrees, promotes, supports something that's unclean will be judged the same way. Amen? Don't touch what's unclean and then I will receive you. So those are requirements. Other than that, we are disconnected. Let me tell you, probably more than 50% of the body of Christ is disconnected, even though they say they're believers. They're disconnected. But they claim to be believers. But there truly is no relationship in the spirit. It's to go to church, pay tithe, do their own thing, go home, build families, purchase this, build that, give all God glory, but no connect. See, connect says this. We hear, we receive, we believe, we execute what he says, not what we say. Does everybody understand that? That's, as a servant of the Lord, as a child of the Most High God, and as a steward of his goods. The worst thing we can do is be successful in the wrong assignment. Amen? Okay, let's go a little further. Are you ready? Come on. Verse 18, what does it say? And I'll be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters. That's connect. When he is father to you, you're connecting. When you know that you're his son and daughter, that's connecting. When you lose that connect of father, then he becomes God. And it's a disconnect. 7:1. Therefore, having what? These promises, beloved, let us what? It's a requirement. Cleanse ourselves from all the filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Those are requirements. The word says, be holy for I'm holy. What's another requirement? The Lord says what? Forgive and you'll be what? Forgiven. You know how many people are still holding bitterness towards somebody? Well, man, you don't know what they did to me. Who cares? Who cares? You think God cares? No. Does anybody understand? He doesn't care what they've done to you. He's looking at you, not the other person. He's saying, will you give me that and forgive? Because if you can't forgive, I can't do anything about it. See, we have a tendency to tie the hands of God. There's a law of sowing and reaping. Whatever you sow, you reap. So to the flesh, you reap corruption. So to the spirit, you reap life. Those requirements will either qualify or disqualify. So we're going to be either qualified or disqualified. But I'm sharing with you right now, the enemy is trying to disconnect. I can't emphasize it enough. At the last few teachings, the Spirit is just telling me over and over, my children are being disconnected from me. And then they're going astray. It's time to reconnect. Amen? Matthew 6. Must meet the criteria of heaven, not of earth. Matthew chapter 6. Verse 31. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Therefore, do not worry. Hello. Don't what? Don't worry. Why? Because worry will disqualify or release. Oh, you don't know my circumstance. So what? God knows it all, doesn't he? He sees it all, knows it all. He's willing to do whatever it takes as long as you get qualified for the release. Don't worry. Saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows what you need. All these things. But, here's a requirement. What does it say? Seek first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What's he saying? Remove the influence of worldly desire. What are you going to do? You're going to remove that with his righteousness. See, there's a difference between good and evil and righteousness. Where people say, well, I'm a good person. Well, if you're not producing the fruits of righteousness, which is the fruits of the Spirit, then you're eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and you're only producing good, not righteousness. See, it's the fruits of righteousness that gets a person into heaven, not the fruits of good. Remember, Jesus is looking for Jesus. Jesus is looking for Jesus. Does he see Jesus or does he see you? Jesus is looking for Jesus. Amen? Seek the kingdom of God and his required righteousness, and there'll be a release that will come. In 1 John chapter 3, qualified releases. Oh, yes. In verse 18. Now, I want you to understand something. There's no coincidence that you're here today and why this message was prepared. God knows everyone in this room needs this message today. Not only for us, but to give. Amen. In verse 18, what does it say? My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And by this we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence toward God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we what? Keep his commandments. That's a requirement, isn't it? Well, his commandments are something he's asking you to do. And do those things that are what? Pleasing to him. So those two requirements, keeping his commandments and doing things that please him. Those are requirements. By doing those things, there is a qualified release. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on him, which means follow on his name, and the Son of Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave his commandment. Now he who keeps his commandments does what? That's a requirement, abiding in him. And he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. So we keep his requirements by staying in the boundaries of protection that he's given me and you. But see, these commandments are keeping me and you in boundaries. There should be a sensitivity to the boundaries that God has given me and you. When you get close to these boundaries, you should be sensitive enough to say, you know what? I'm getting close to something that's going to displease God. And that's where people step over those boundaries, because you know why? You can only step over a boundary and ignore it when there's a disconnect. Only when there's a connect, it's like a barbed-wired fence that's connected to electricity. When you're connected, you sense there's a power coming off of that boundary. You're getting close to it. Is everybody with me? But when there's a disconnect, you don't know. You just bump into it or walk over it or whatever. Again, it's vital that we maintain being connected. Hebrews chapter 10. Is everybody okay? Qualified releases. Hebrews 10, verse 26. Let's speak it together, please. For if we what? Sin when? Willfully. In other words, you've been disconnected. If we sin willfully after we receive the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins. In other words, disconnect. For a certain fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation which will devour the adversaries. Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who has what? Trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace. Hallelujah. That is powerful. He said, look, you willfully sin, you disconnect yourself from me, and you have no right into my kingdom. But you can expect a judgment to come because you have disqualified your entrance into eternal life. But I thought once saved, always saved. That's a lie from hell. Since when can you get into the kingdom of God while you're still serving the devil? That is not the doctrine of eternal life. That is the doctrine of the devil. Is everybody okay? And listen, if I don't tell you, then the blood's on my hands. Verse 30, for we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But recall the former days in which after you were illuminated, endured a great struggle with sufferings, partly while you were made a spectacle both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were treated. For you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a what? Better and an enduring possession for yourselves, where? In heaven. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. Are you ready for 36? Let's read it together. For you have need of what? Endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the what? That's a qualified release. For yet a little while, he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but those who believe in to the saving of the soul. So what is a requirement? A need for endurance. Amen? That takes discipline. That takes self-control. That means that you and I must submit to the criteria of his will to receive the promise or reward, which is a qualified release. Luke 9. Luke chapter 9. Turn to your neighbor and ask him, you getting this? Luke chapter 9, verse 23. And Jesus said to them all, what? If anyone desires to what? Come after me, let him what? Deny himself. Hallelujah. Here's a requirement. And take up his cross. In other words, fight. And then you can what? Follow me. Follow me. Follow me. Follow me. That's what the word believe means. Follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will what? Lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is a man if he gains the whole world and he himself is destroyed or lost? For whoever is ashamed of me. See, we are ashamed of him when we disobey him. And we're not ashamed of him when we obey him. Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him, the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes and in his own glory and his Father's and the holy angels. But I tell you truly, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. Again, there's an area of denying ourselves, picking up our cross and following. That is a formula. That is a requirement. Deny yourself. Deny yourself. Deny yourself. Deny yourself. But I feel. But I believe. I believe. No, what does he say? What does he say? It's not anything else. You know, there's a difference between fact and truth. The fact says, okay, I broke my leg. The truth says, by his stripes, I'm healed. Does everybody understand that? The fact says, I was an addict. But the truth says, I'm a new creation in Christ, where all things pass away and all things become new. See, when you take truth over fact, freedom is starting. Now you're qualifying yourself for not only freedom, but to receive from God. Oh, glory. Isaiah 55. And your answers ought to be yes and amen. Amen. Not but. Amen. Or if. Isaiah 55. Praise God. We had a glorious meeting Friday night. Amen. I'll tell you what. I'm still... Woo-hoo! I've been laughing since Friday night. I'm Glory. Isaiah 55. Is everybody there? In verse 1. Oh, everyone who thirsts, come and what? To the waters. And you have no money, come and do what? Buy. That means price, cooperate, and eat. Yes, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread or things that are not eternal? And your wages for what does not satisfy. Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and let your soul delight itself into abundance. See, God is not speaking physically. He's speaking spiritually. Incline your ear and come to me here, and your soul shall live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, the sure mercies of David. Indeed, I have given him as a witness to the people, a leader and a commander for the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be what? Found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. Let the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return to the Lord. And he will have mercy on him and to our God. For he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and to make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my what? Word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return void, but it shall what? Accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing that which I sent it. So understand, God is trying to get us something. He delights in his children to prosper. But too many times we get disconnected and disqualified, and the enemy comes and steals. Is everybody okay? James chapter 4. After we do the will, we receive the promise. James chapter 4. Hallelujah. Is everybody there? We're going to start somewhere. Start at verse 1. Where do what? Wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires or emotions or lusts for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and don't have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you don't ask. You ask and don't receive it because you ask amiss. And when you don't get it, you try to fix it yourself. You ask and don't receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasures, your lusts, or your will. Let me share something with you. When it's not God's time, it's not God's will. God's will is always associated with his time. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of God or a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously? But he gives more grace, therefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore what? Submit to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. So submitting to God means you're doing the things that will what? Qualify for a release. You know, it's amazing how many times we qualify for a release and God gives us something and then we mess up. Amen? We mess up. And we mess up because of a disconnect. Does everybody understand it? Why? Because we hear the voice of the stranger that influences. Remember, God never interrupts himself. Never. Anything that's interrupted, even when you reconnect, you must reap it. Everybody reaps no matter what, if we allow things to happen. It's our responsibility to make what is unseen seen and to keep things clean. To do what? Everyone say it. Make things unseen seen and things clean. We're Mr. and Mrs. Clean. Let's go to James 1 while we're here. In verse 5. And we'll start at 2. My brethren, count it all joy. When? Not if. When. You fall into what? Various trials. What are the trials for? To mature us. To mature us. Why? Because there's areas where you think you're mature, but God says you're immature here. So he's going to bring you to, he's going to allow various trials to mature us. Why? So we're unmovable. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, or what we call endurance. Remember, we're going to need endurance to be qualified. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect, complete, and what? Lacking nothing. That means you are solid. You are immovable. You're going to go all the way through no matter what. Nothing's going to move you from position. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it'll be given to him. But let me tell you this. When you ask him, you got to ask in faith with no doubting. Why? Because that will disqualify. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from God or from the Lord. Why? Because he's double-minded. He's got one eye on himself and one eye on the world. One eye on himself and one eye on the world. We're supposed to have one eye on God all the time and one eye on your enemy. Hallelujah. Is everybody okay? Are you getting this? He's double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Unstable. Remember, God wants to get us to a place where we are stable, immovable, not moved by lust, not moved by desires, not moved by someone else's flirtations, not moved by other things of the world. We are stable. We are lovers of truth. And because we are lovers of truth, we're lovers of him. And because we're lovers of him, we do everything we can to stay connected, and we hate anything that tries to disconnect. And if you don't hate anything that disconnects, then you're not a lover of him and you don't love truth. Ephesians 4. And you can't blame somebody for getting you out of position. You know why we get in trouble? We bring it on ourselves. You can't blame the devil for deceiving you. You can't blame someone else for affecting you. We allow it. Ephesians 4, is everybody there? Verse 17. Would you read it with me? This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God. That's disconnect. Because of the what? Ignorance that is in them. Because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling, emotionally misled, have given themselves over to lewdness, to work in all uncleanness with greediness. But you have not so learned Christ. You've been disconnected. If indeed you have heard from him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Here it is. Are you ready? We need to get qualified. What does he say? Therefore, put away what? Lying. Let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and don't sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. people are easily swayed and given place to the devil. Why? Because they're disconnected. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give to him who is in need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth. Grumble, complain. But what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not what? Grieve the Holy Spirit. That will bring a disconnect. You grieve the Holy Spirit, you just disconnected. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, again, there are still people who are holding bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. But be what? Kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as even as God in Christ forgave you. Oh, hallelujah. Make no place for the devil. Things that disqualify our release. Everybody wants something from God. Amen? We need a healing. We need something done. We need more freedom. There's something that's going on in our life. We might need a job. We might need whatever it may be. We don't want to be disqualified by displeasing him and being disconnected or touching something unclean. Is everybody okay? I'd like to go to Proverbs 3. Proverbs chapter 3. Qualified releases. Again, we bring these things on ourselves, don't we? Verse 1, it says, my son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck, write them on the tablet of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. What does it say? Here's a requirement. Are you ready? Trust in the Lord with what? All your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, do what? Acknowledge him. And he will what? Direct your paths. Don't be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. These are all requirements to qualify us for release and promises of God. What does he say? Look at this. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of your increase. Honor him. So your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, my daughter, don't despise the chastening and correcting of the Lord, nor detest his corrections. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. So God will correct us. He said, look, don't forget these requirements. So, listen, there's an area where when we get into the place where we have to survival mode, we begin to fight for us. Surrender mode begins to surrender, and he does the fight for us. Amen? We want to come into that place where we're constantly acknowledged. We've got one eye on the Lord, one eye on our enemy, so we can always stay in position. Who's telling me this? Where is this influence coming? Why? We always must look at where's the source. What's the source of this? People just listen to any kind of music they want. They want to watch all kinds of stuff, listen to this, read books, and not even knowing what the source of it is. Because if the source is evil, it releases evil. If the source is righteous, it releases righteous. Amen? In Proverbs 29. In verse 29 to 22. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. An angry man stirs up strife, and a furious man abounds in transgression. A man's pride will bring him what? Low. But the humble in spirit will retain honor. Whoever is a partner with a thief hates his life. Whoa. What's this thief? A person that's stealing truth. It's everybody got it. It's a person that steals truth. He swears to what? Tell the truth. Oh, come on, are you with me? He swears to tell the truth, but he what? Reveals nothing, because what's he stealing? Truth. People partner up with people that steal truth from them. Verse 25. The fear of man brings what? A snare. But whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe. Oh, praise God. The fear of man brings a snare. Man, don't let man sway you. Don't let people sway you. That's what got King David in trouble. I mean, King Saul. He said he believed the voice, he listened to the voice of the people instead of the voice of God, and God threw him out from kingship. He said, that's enough. And kingship represents warrior. We're to be soldiers in the body of Christ, warriors. The word says, as a good soldier, don't entangle yourself with the affairs of this world. We are entering a season in time right now where things are crazy out there. They're getting worse. They're not getting better. A falling away has begun. It's been going on. People are falling away. They're falling away to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, seducing and seductive spirits, bound by lust. People from the body of Christ still claiming to be believers are compromised truth. They've become lazy. And they're now beginning to agree with what the world is saying. We can't allow that to happen. We can't allow it to happen to you as an individual. You must love truth and hate anything else that's against truth. Amen? Is everybody okay? 1 Peter chapter 5. First Peter chapter 5. In verse 5. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you be submissive to one another and be clothed with what? Humility. For God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Therefore what? Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time. Or release. Release. His promise to you, it will come as long as you maintain being qualified. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time, casting your cares. Hello? That's a qualification, isn't it? Cast your cares upon him for what? He cares for you. Be sober, be alert, be vigilant, be consistent, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. We must resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. Everybody is going through it. But the whole thing is to go through it, not get stuck in it. Amen? Go through it. Go to Luke 14. These are all areas where God says, I'm going to qualify you or disqualify you. The days are evil. Things are getting worse. In Luke 14, in verse 26, well, here's a kicker of qualification. Are you ready? Are we going to speak this together? That way we all know we're accountable. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother and wife and children, brothers, sisters, yes, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. That's a qualification or disqualification. Ooh. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish? Thus, after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see him begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he's able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. That's a requirement. It's amazing how we just take these things, read them, and just, whatever. Because that's what's going on right now. That's the influence of demonic forces. That's an area where people are no longer keeping the fear of God, staying connected. They're just doing whatever they feel like doing. And the question, here's their justification. Oh, God knows. He knows that I'm pure-hearted towards this. No. That's not how it is. God knows that our heart is deceptive. That's why he says, maintain a pure heart. Get a new heart, he even says. That's why you and I need to exchange our heart. And get rid of it sometimes. Lord, I exchange my heart for your heart. Why? Because I've just done something that I know displeases you. Obviously, my heart's not right. If I'm out of God's time, I'm out of God's order. And I cannot receive the promise because I've been disqualified. Remember, the enemy's trying to disqualify us in everything. That's his job. Hallelujah. First John chapter 5. Almost done. Another 35 scriptures will be good. We want to make sure Randy fills up his pad there. Do we need to take this serious? Yeah. Glory. 1 John chapter 5, it's somewhere in here. In verse 18. It says, we know that whoever is born of God does not sin. But he has been born of God, keeps himself, and the wicked one doesn't touch him. We know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the what? Sway of the wicked one. We know that the Son of God has come and given us an understanding that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, and in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from what? Idols. 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 Keep ourselves from things that interrupt. Amen. In between you and God. Keep yourselves away from that. In Revelation 3. Jesus has come to bring us life and life abundantly. But the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Revelation 3:17. Says, because you say I'm rich, in other words, because we say I'm okay, I'm good, no problem, snap, because you say I'm okay, I'm rich, I've become wealthy, I have no need of nothing, I'm good, and don't know, Jesus says, that you are wretched. You're miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Now I counsel you to buy from me, that's a price, gold refined in fire, that you may be rich in white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and that you may anoint your eyes with eye salve so that you may see clearly. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and to him and dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, and as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who's got an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to him today. Today. Amen? Today. Oh, praise God. I'm going to go to the book of Hebrew. In chapter 3. In verse 7. Would you read it with me there? Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says today, if you will hear his voice, and do not harden your hearts in the what? Rebellion. That's a disqualification, isn't it? In the day of trial, in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me and tried me and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said they what? They always go astray where? In their hearts. And they have not known my ways. Why? Because there was a disconnect. So I swore in my wrath, they will not enter my rest. They won't have peace. They'll have false peace. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become what? Partakers of Christ, if, that's a qualification, if we what? Hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end, while it said today, if you will hear his voice and do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who having heard rebelled, indeed was it not all who came out of Egypt, which is bondage, led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but those who did not obey, because they were what? Disqualified. So we see that they could not enter in because of what? Unbelief. In John chapter 7, and we'll close here. Qualified releases. Let me share with you, just because you got qualified for one release doesn't mean you're qualified for another. Each release has a specific qualification. In John chapter 7. Hallelujah. In verse 37. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, is that a qualification? Yes. Let him come to me and what? Drink. See, if you are not in a place of desiring to want to know more about him and seek, then you're not one who's thirsty. And to be thirsty is a qualification. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. And he who believes in me, the word believe means to follow. As the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Well, I want you to know, Jesus has been glorified, and the Spirit is still being poured out. And without the presence of God and the Spirit of God dwelling in me and you, it's very difficult to connect. Because the only thing that connects us to the other side is the Spirit of God. See, we can have head knowledge. Head knowledge connects us with knowledge. Heart. Heart to heart. That's what he's looking for. This is relationship. That's connection, because the walk is inner, not outer. Amen. It's inner. We know what we're doing when we're pleasing Him. We know when we hear His voice. We know when we are oppressed. We know when a witness comes within our spirit. We know the things that, believe me, He already told, the Bible says that the Spirit tells us things to come. Amen. He warns us. We know. He says the Holy Spirit tells you everything, that we know everything. The anointing allows us to know everything. So we really don't have an excuse. We're accountable for everything that we do. And one day we'll stand before Him and be accountable of everything we've done. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is reverence, honor, and respect. You cannot have the fear of the Lord without connect. It's not a terror. The enemy brings terror and torment. God brings peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. Amen? Let's get qualified for every release and get an ear what the Spirit is saying. Come to that place of qualification where we're willing to deny ourselves. We're willing to walk away from ourselves. We're willing to walk away from those things that displease God. And willing to do whatever it takes to please Him. Amen? Praise God. Father, we are honored and blessed with Your word today. I ask, Father, that the seed that's been imparted will grow root and bear fruit. It'll not only go from head but to heart. And that You'll be before us all the time, that this truth will be before us because You are truth. And whatever we do, that we all acknowledge You and see You through everything, looking through the physical into the spiritual, exposing the enemy with one eye and keeping the other eye on You, that we may please You all the days of our life, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.